isn't in me so deep. I wanna tell you something. Dressed in a stunning red, your head upon my chest, the pain inside means nothing.
Ready for them? Go ahead.
Hey everyone, Justin here from Pangolin, and just want to welcome you to today's live stream that's going to be covering zone offsets and beyond. And before we begin, we just wanted to take a moment as a team and really share some positive news with you on some pockets of good news that are taking place throughout the industry. So we spent the last few weeks just talking with clients from around the world, and we're getting a lot of reports that projects are still going to be taking place. Events are being not being canceled, but postponed, which we think is really, really good news. And even on that light, we're starting to hear of some projects that are actually going full steam ahead. We've got some clients over in Korea who are working on a giant multimedia project there, on top of one of the largest buildings in Seoul, Korea. There's a massive project in Switzerland taking place with an opera house there that is still going full steam ahead. And we've been talking to Disney about some projects that they're working on as well. And we wanted to share this with you just to keep you encouraged, to keep you motivated, and let you know that despite what's happening right now, the show is gonna go on. Events are gonna continue to take place. And we just kinda wanna assure all of you that you know, there is gonna be an end to this all, and stuff is gonna start picking up sooner rather than later. And while it's slow, we really wanna encourage you all to do a few things. We're a part of different groups and different business masterminds, and we hear a lot of feedback about just great stuff you can do while things are slow. One is, we would encourage you to reach out to your own personal clients that you've worked with in the past. Get on the phone and call them, see how they're doing, see how your customers are weathering the storm. Be proactive in communicating with your clients and stuff like that, and let them know that once this thing is over, you're gonna be prepared to help provide some kick-ass laser shows to them. We're trying to do the same thing with you guys as our clients, and we would encourage you to do the same thing with your clients as well, just to keep the communication lines going. In addition, as you guys have known, we're putting out tons of educational content right now. our creative director, Lyra, who's kind of spearheading this initiative. She's here with us today, and she's just churning out tons of content for you guys to enjoy. So soak it up and send us feedback. If there's videos that you want to see, trainings that you want to go more in depth on, or just information that you want, reach out. If you want a private training session, you know, it's slow for us too right now. We're here to do that. We're organizing these with a lot of the larger production companies right now. But if you as an individual out there just want some time with Pangolin, reach out to us. We want to be here for you as much as we can. And we would encourage you to practice and refine your craft so that at the end of this thing, we as an industry are just putting out better laser shows as a result. And we're there as an industry to help our clients and just to add that added wow factor to events that will be coming on. So, as we said before, today's live stream, it's going to cover zone offsets. So a zone offset is a type of effect that's going to delay other effects across multiple projectors in a laser setup. And it really allows you to create some incredible geometric patterns. I'm sure you've seen them in some of Lyra's shows. She's really a master of this. It's going to be similar to how lighting designers program their lighting rigs these days. So that's what today's live stream is going to cover. I want to pass it over to our founder, president, and CTO, Mr. Bill Benner. He's going to kind of share a State of the Union address from Pangolin just to let you know a little bit more about what's going on internally here and what we're doing to weather the storm. So, Bill?
Yeah, great. Yeah, thanks, Justin. So I think a fair question that anybody could be asking out there with all this stuff going on is of any company, is how are we doing? How is Pangolin doing? Yep. That would be an entirely fair thing to ask. And we're doing well. We are financially positioned to weather the storm. The way we operate the company, we kept a lot of money in the bank. We didn't, we're 100% debt free. We've never done anything foolish with the money. And so we are well positioned to weather the storm. Mm-hmm. We maintained our full staff. We haven't cut anybody, and we haven't cut anybody's hours. In terms of the ScannerMax people, many of those people are home, and they're able to work from home because it's all hand assembly. We've sent them home with parts kits, and they've got microscopes and everything else. But in terms of the management and the whole admin team, and many of the people are still working in the office, and sometimes with overlapping shifts so that we can maintain proper social distancing. But the State of the Union is strong, and so we're well positioned to weather the storm, and we want to help. And one of the things that I learned in scuba diving is, in order for you to help other people, you've got to be strong, right? So when we are strong, and we're here to help, another question people would be having is the event business over? What's happening? And we want to be the source of good news, because I tell you what, God knows if you're listening to the Crisis News Network or the Calamity News Network or the Continuously Negative News Network or any of those other news networks, it's going to be all bad all the time. But it isn't all bad. There is good news, and we're in a great place to know, because anytime the events are happening, they need to buy stuff from us, or sometimes rent lasers from us, or get things from us.
And it's not only that, but we as a company, I know you were doing a lot of this as well. We were reaching out to clients from all different market segments, our partners over in Asia, our partners in Europe, our partners in South America, our industrial clients, and the overwhelming response has been, it's not canceled, it's just postponed. And people are still proactively gearing up for what I think is going to really be a huge push once this thing comes to a close.
Yeah, for sure. They're going to be pent-up demand. J-Hack on Instagram had a great thing. He said, it's not, this is just intermission.
Yeah.
Just think about this as an intermission. Just like what happens in the opera and some long movies.
Absolutely.
This is just the intermission.
Yeah.
So, there is good news. We want to be the source of good news. What did you come up with, Justin? A shining beacon?
Yeah, we really kind of, I mean,
a you beacon know, of light, or
a beacon of light. We don't want to focus on the negative. We want to focus on the positive. Right now it's slow, but take the time to refine your craft. Take the time to experiment with different things that maybe you didn't have the time to do before. And like Bill was saying earlier, we really tried our best to manage the company in a fiscally responsible manner. So if you need a hand, if you need access to tools or resources, or say you were using QuickShow and you wanted to go to Beyond and you can't afford it, email us, call us. It's not about the business right now. It's about the industry. It's
and
about supporting
people and relationships.
It's about building relationships, being there for each other. And you know, all business aside, we want to make, we don't have a business without you guys, right? So that's the reality of the situation. So our number one priority is making sure you as clients have access to the resources you need, the tools you need to weather this storm, and we're going to be there for you. So
and we're able to do that because we are strong.
Yep. We try to be strong and to be a beacon of light, as we were saying before, for you guys. So that's kind of what's going on internally. Kind of what we're just trying to, again, be positive, share a positive message. Lyra's really put a lot of effort into today's live stream, so we're gonna pass it over to her here and kind of dig right in. So Lyra.
Woo! So before we do that, actually, we're gonna do a quick little fun little show, just to, you know, who doesn't love a bunch of, who doesn't love lasers, right? So, just let me load up my other zone file and then we will play a quick show for you. Are you ready to show? Oh, yep. There you go.
In me so deep, I wanna tell you something. Dressed in a stunning red, your head upon my chest, the pain inside means nothing. Take off your shirt and lay down, right now.
All right, cool. So hope you enjoyed that little show. And now I'm just going to throw into our, we're gonna go into our little education segment on offset effects. So I'm just gonna quickly load up my little zone here. We will go there, that's my zone. And so zone offset effects, let me throw one up really quick and then we'll talk about it briefly. So if we can just throw, sure, that perfect, that's great. So basically zone offset effects, right? So if you think about in Beyond, right, we have effects that usually affect each projector overall, right? So the whole projector set. So this effect right here in my, it's just a size, right? or if I have something like this, right? This is a position X and Y with a 50% offset and ping pong smooth just to have a round circle. So, but this is doing them all at the same time. What people really want to learn how to do, and some people have found it, but what people really want to do is be able to do this, right? They want to be able to offset those things to create more like lighting style looks, I guess you could say, and make these sorts of things. And as well, it's not just this, it's not just kind of simple shapes. What it also is things like this, right? So this is a cue that has a wave, but inside of it is this power effect and color effect that goes through the projectors on an offset time. And these are the things that people want to do to help improve their shows. And this is kind of a way in this type of cue where you can build a cue that has offsets. So it's not all just each projector is doing every single thing the same. And as the show scales, it's not going to be weird. So let's get into it. So basically, there's a few different ways we can go about this. The first way, and the very easiest way of doing it, is a simple old effect, right? So if we pull up just a circle, and I'm just going to throw on my quick effects. If we want to go to there, and then we'll make lasers in the bottom corner if we can. All right, perfect. So with this, we just have a simple effect that does size, just brings the size down so that we can do it. But let's add another effect onto another line down here. So in this case, let's do a very simple effect, and we'll do a zoom, right? So we're going from 10% to 100% of the whole thing. So maybe we can do it at full size. And this is just a very simple effect. Everyone's used this. Everybody knows this effect. So we want to make this offset. Now, where is the offset hidden, right? So basically what you need to do is in any effect layer, and this in case is a layer, we right click on the effect or any effect in the thing, and we go to effect properties. Now in the effect properties window, there's this little drop down here called multi-zone time shift. And this is that slider. Is it going to do it because I have something else running? That's that slider. So if we look at something like this, for instance, this is that one there, and I'm going to throw that size on there. And we'll make sure we select it. We right click, we go to effect properties, and then this is that offset. So if I go in here, I can change that offset. Now this offset is the like the ultimate offset. So it's always going to be that offset. And so we can set an offset that we like. Maybe it's one beat per zone. And that's how it's calculated. So in this case, we have multi-zone time shift, BPM shift. This is one BPM shift per zone. And so that's how that works. And that's how you get that offset. Or you could do, you know, 0.1 and make it barely. Or you could increase it. Or you can put any value you want if you really want to. You can get all really super precise about it. And that's how you can do that. Now, if you have something that's a clock instead, so let's say our position X is actually time-based, right? So if we go into the effect properties and we add a time-based offset, then we could have those two offsets working together to create some sort of look if you wanted to time it in any way that makes sense. So you can create kind of more ballyhoo looks and things like that. So this is kind of an ultimate offset. Now the other thing that's in here is you can click enable master effect shift for this effect. And what that is this allows us to use, under the master tab, this little slider right here. This is the effect time shift slider. So live, I can change that effect slider. So I could map this to a MIDI controller. It's just like any object. You could use Pango script. You could map it to a MIDI controller. It's just a parameter or slider inside of Beyond. And I can do offsets on the time as well. So you can create these offsets and then live change them. So you could create a bunch of content or in the queue itself that has these offsets and then are just assigned to the master effect shifts like that and have master effect shifts that you can control live all the time. Or you could create queues themselves that have it inside. So you could have like that other queue that I showed you originally over here. This is built inside. So if we get inside this queue really quick, this queue itself has one layer of effects, which is all the waves, which make this really crazy kind of wave. But that offset is not in there. So if we go here, That's that, all the effects there. This layer is my layer that I want to have the offset. So this color and power effect, which moves through the queue itself, if you right click here and go to queue properties, you'll see I have a BPM shift of 0.5 placed into this effect right here, but not placed in this effect. So in those that group, you can do one group at a time. So you can create looks that do these offsets of only part of the object. So if you only want to have, let's say, the color and power, and like in this case, be offset, then you don't have to do anything. You can separate those that way. And you can build them into queues. And that's my way of doing it. I prefer to do it that way. That's my first choice. But it's also not a bad idea to just build them in your effects grid, you know? If we make sure that everything is reset, then we should be able to do our offsets and whatnot here. So you can create those offsets and build them into your effects list. And so that's one of those kind of, that's kind of the classic way of doing it. And it's the way that most people have done it in the past, and the way most people have done this kind of offset effect. The other newer way of doing it is using what we call multi-effects. So if I show a couple quick examples of the multi-effects, these are queues in a sense, and they're just effects itself. So even though I'm on one queue and I have this running here, I also have this this effect running as well. So those are, they're not kind of counting as a queue because it's an effect. So this is how you can create more offsets that are more like, you know, on a grand MA, you do a negative two wings and you do your certain selections, which is a very popular thing to do. You can make looks that look kind of like that using this multi-effect. And you could create an entire page of these multi-effects and place it in your secondary workspace on the bottom. So you could say maybe you have your multi-effects here, and then you have your content up in your workspace up here. So let's take a look at those now. So the way multi-effects, first of all, if you want to make one, you right-click on any empty cell, you go to Create, and you go to New Multi-Effect. And this is the multi-effect window. It's similar to most all multi-effects, or most queue types, where you have your new, open, and save, and then a couple quick options. It's fairly simple otherwise. And so the way that this works is this is kind of an effect bank, right? The first queue here is kind of like an effect bank. And the very simple thing you can do is you can add a effect of some type like this. So let's just turn it on so we have it and we can look at it. Now this is one effect, and you could add a shift, but since this is only one effect, it's not going to matter so much. If we add a second though, and this is kind of a secondary bank of effect in this one queue, we can have this follow the effect of one. So in this case, it's using effect of one, and add a beat shift. And because there's two, every two zones that are currently selected, it will do that effect over those two zones, just repeating. Now if we make it three and we do another offset, well, now we've done it every three. And every four, five, and six, just like that. And you can add those offsets. Now the other thing you can do is, instead of that, is you can have its own effect entirely. So every two instead, you're like, well, I want odds to be able to be zooming, but then I want evens to be a color effect. You can build these into one queue, if it were, of content, and then create those sorts of things. So if we take a look at some examples here, we have a zoom effect, which is built off of six areas, just with offsets as you go along the line here, all following effect of one. This is another example here that just uses three banks, so you can see how three repeating might look. This one is also similar to rotations, but it just kind of has kind of random offsets to kind of make something more random and more less predictable looking. And that just goes on there. And the big benefit of this is that if you have more than six projectors on another show, let's say you build your main show file for six or eight or 10 projectors, if you have, let's say you built it for six, and let's say you have 12 on another show. Well, because of the way that this adds up, the next six zones in order will be also offset.
Now, Lara, it's been a pretty big trend with projectors to put larger and larger quantities on. It seems like one of the trends is lower wattage, higher quantity. And so would you feel that this is easy to scale up across even bigger numbers of projectors as we might get up into 20, 30 projectors or so?
Yeah, because as the math adds together, you basically, the best way to do it is to pick factors, mm-hmm. right? So if you have, if you're like, I'm always going to work in factors of four, or mm-hmm. I'm always going to work in factors of eight. Mm-hmm. Let's say that most of the time your shows are like, I use 8 projectors, 16 projectors, 32 projectors, then build, you want to build your main live workspace with eight, like for eight, so, because then the math will just add up.
So
and then
like
during your setup, you just want to think about order.
So pick like a quantity or groups of lasers that you normally work in and scale up like that.
Right, and if you're doing a giant show that's very specific, and if they have a giant show, hopefully you've given, you've put an extra day rate on there for home programming, uh-huh. right? You can create even more complex multi-effects where you can even make it like a 2D grid, and then inside of these, you can have many different effects, and you can even assign projection zones for each one of these banks. So you can get really in-depth and create things that are just one-hit shots, and they do what you do and all the effects on one hit. And then obviously with your content, if you want to change the content, you just change the content and they'll just follow the effects. So in that way, it's quite similar to how you might think about it for lighting and whatnot. Another cool thing you can do with this kind of thing is like think about color, right? So with color here, we've built this thing that kind of comes from center and goes out. So all we did with this was we have effects on 1 and 4. 4 has a flip. And then 5, 6 have different offsets. So 6 is using effect of 4, but it has no beat shift. Then 5 has a beat shift of 1, and 4 has a beat shift of 2. Similarly this way, this is using effect of 1 and a beat shift of 2, 1, and beat shift of 0 on the original cue. So you can create these kind of zoom out effects, and you could create a whole line. If you know that your show is going to be very often having one large wide stage, you could build one line. Or if you know that you're going to have banks of twos, you could do a grid of some sort and make a grid and time your things out based on a grid that makes sense. And you just assign those zones to where you would assign them. So this is kind of how that multi-effects works. And you can also do this with like power effect. So that's another kind of interesting way to use this stuff is with things like power effects. And because it's just the same effects engine and bank as everything else in Beyond, there's no changes to how you can use every effect that's in there. So it doesn't matter what effect it is. It's just a tool to build those effects. And then the last one we want to look at probably pretty in depth, which is the one I've been teasing the whole time, is this multi-effect here, which has this very traditional lighting look where it's kind of the cross and the wings -2, which those of you who are MA programmers know what I'm talking about. And the way that we built this was on number one, we have an effect, which is basically just X and Y doing a circle, and then a size so that it makes the circle smaller, so that whatever the content that you have, it fits in and doesn't clip off the edges. And then number two has a beat shift on it, and three has a beat shift on it as well. And then number four is the same effect with the same size, but with just an x-axis flip. Mm-hmm. So there, and then the same thing, we did an offset of beat shift of 2 and a beat shift of 4. Now, if you had 8 projectors, or you had, you know, used those factors from when you programmed and thought about the factors of how your shows scale, when you add 6 more projectors onto this, it's just going to follow the same order. So if you had your zones with 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6, if you did 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, and 12, then this whole look will match and look exactly the same on that other zone setup without having to change your programming at all.
So right. Tell us a little bit about your control setup right now and how you're running this the zone offsets here.
Well, it's just Beyond. I have actually no MIDI controller. It's just Beyond mouse and keyboard in this setup. There's no need for any other control. I've got an MA sitting in front of me, but that's for haste.
So let's talk a little bit about that. But, I mean, there's been obviously a lot of, there's a big trend in controlling the projectors directly from the console. So how would I use zone offsets if I was running this, let's say, live from an MA?
Well, in most cases, people who are going to use a console are going to want to use the effects engine built into their console, right? Now, if you're doing something super basic, and let's say you're using the 16-channel mode to just control Quick Show, then you could, you know, in theory, create these types of looks and add them on top of whatever the console person on the console is controlling for triggering of a cue, right? So if they're like, well, I want to trigger the shape and I want to trigger the color, but the offsets you grab or whatever, you could make them and pull them up later. Otherwise, if you want individual control, which is what console control users want, for the most part, is using Beyond Server, which we could get into if we want, but I think I'd rather, let's look at some questions first about zone offsets, and if people are interested in Beyond Server, then I can talk about Beyond Server as well.
Okay.
I have no problems with that. So do we have any questions rolling in?
Yeah, guys, keep some questions rolling in. We're not seeing too many in the thread right now. It could just be that the feature is that simple to use.
It's really not that hard, and if you don't want to get into the multi-effect world, then it's super easy to actually just go through some of your, like, don't tease that. Go through some of your content, let's say some content like this, right? Go into my content and flag in the effects, flag it for enable master offset, right? And if I do this and I throw a beat offset, I can just have offsets in it. Like, I can just throw offsets anytime, any place. So it's easy to just go into your content, enable the master offset, and use that master offset on your live shows without having to actually do any, without having to do that much work. And then you can tune the offset with your fader based on how many projectors you have. So if you have 40 projectors on one Beyond system, then you might only need like 0.5 beat offset. And it will look awesome. But, you know, maybe if you're only using like 6, you would tune it to something that makes sense. And once you find a resonance that makes the most sense for your setup, you can usually probably just leave it there. And then as you trigger your cues that have this enabled, the movements will work for the most part.
Well, guys, we got some questions rolling in, and thank you for posting them. So Giovanni is asking us, how would we use this then on a timeline-based show? And you were addressing that a little bit earlier, but maybe we'll go into a bit more depth for Giovanni here.
So for a timeline show, you're going to need to do, you aren't going to be able to use the, well, you could use the what's it called? The master effect time shift slider, but it's better to throw it into and do it inside of here first and then put the content on the timeline. If you're wanting to do offsets in a timeline like that, you could use buses. So using a bus in a timeline, like at the bottom, and then adding an effect in here, you could add that offset in that effect in the bus, which will control all the projectors inside of the setup. And then the bus is based on the order of the tracks, which is then based on the order of the zones and the tracks. So okay. Your order of zones would be based on that order in the tracks.
Mark Housden, Mark, it's good to hear from you, man. Hope you're doing well. He's got a great question. We get asked this a lot. It's a very simple one. So how do I make a color chase from left to right?
So if you want to make a color chase left to right, probably the easiest way to do it would be, so my in this case, all of my cues are in the order of 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So if I were to have an effect, I think it will work this way. I'm almost certain it will. The best probably way is probably to use color effect, and then we'll do a color effect by time. And we will run it at, let's say, 25. And then let me just make something that looks pretty cool. Just going to throw in one of my favorite color combinations and hits. White into purple into blue. And my technique for this, as a little side hint, is I like to fill in there, and then just that way when I allocate, it's just nice and easy to allocate them all colors linearly. And then once you add this, we can add this, and then it'll go there. Now, if you want to go the other way, you just go negative, and you can do the same thing. If you want it to be like drawing out, then you're going to have to do something like the multi-effect. So in the multi-effect that we built here, it works best on the line to show it off. This one right here, like from center, this is using the multi-effect to do that. Mm-hmm. It is possible to do, it probably is possible. Let's take a look here, actually. Instead of by time, if we do by points, let's see how it's drawn. And then we'll probably need to do, make it a lot smaller. So the way I like to do this is just throw a bunch of extra darks in there and then allocate. And then we probably want to put this to like point, maybe 0.25. And it's the wrong direction, so I would need to flip it and then do a different speed. But for sake of speed, we'll just do this and imagine I drew it on the other side. So if I drew, we'll do it. Might as well. It's not that bad.
So we've got a couple other questions rolling in here. Brad Kellogg. Brad, thanks again for joining us as well. It's good to see you on here. He is asking how that master offset can be scripted to a fader, and if we could maybe touch on that a little bit.
So I think that the master offset is actually in, if you go into the MIDI, it's not in the live control and FX. It is in, I'm not sure actually where it would be. But if you use, so here's a quick little hint otherwise. If you go into settings, configuration, and you go to, it is in laser preview, and you click display internal beyond command. What this does is it displays, hopefully you can see that on screen. Yeah, you should be able to see that. It displays the information here in your preview window as you move things and do things. So if I click a cue, it's also going to give me all that data points that are in, that are happening in the background of Beyond to do that sort of thing. So as you do it here, so you could create a script that would go between, and if for some reason it's not in a default option, then I'll get Alexa to throw it in there. It wouldn't be that hard at all to add it if it's not. I just haven't looked for it recently, so I'm not sure exactly where it might be. I would be surprised if it wasn't in here. Oh yeah, there it is. Master zone, where is it? Master effect clock shift. There it is, right here. So you don't even have to script it. You can just grab one of these. It's a master effect metro shift MIDI in. You could do a slider, and it will change those slider positions right there.
So Mac Han has asked us, how do I get a preview window with all the projectors showing like the output we are here?
So in there, that's the zones. If we go into projection zones, each one of these, what I'll do is I'll black out really quick so we can see them. In the preview window, you can change how your preview looks. So all you need to do is change it to audience scanning, and then you can change the size of this. And you can position it up how you'd like, and then move it over, so like this. And then you can also move the projector position in the space to make it look how you'd like.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you want to flip it, you can do negative instead of positive.
So what might be cool, it looks like most of the questions have been answered. Maybe we'll run through the show once more, and you can kind of comment throughout the show where and how you were using a zone offset.
Actually, that show is just eye candy.
Okay.
It doesn't have any of the zone offsets. My thing is that I program all of my timeline shows independently of each other. And each zone independently of each other, because what that allows me to do is add weird stuff, right? So this allows me to go, well, I might want to do this zone offset thing, but what if I want to randomly grab this one and move it in for some particular reason? So I do it all based on in the timeline without this sort of thing, and I do it manually. So like in the center here, let me play it. There's all these offsets in here, but they're actually just programmed as a shift. So in rotation, they start at, this one starts at zero, but I think that the next one starts at 72, for instance. So the offset's built into the frame itself. And with a projector show like this, which is five projectors with a clone in the middle, It's not too hard. But like I said, you can easily throw, using a bus, on the bottom, you could pretty easily throw an effect on a bus of a rotation, and then in this effect, do an effect property to do a BPM shift of that. So that's how you would do that instead.
Well, any other questions from the community here we can answer, guys?
Yeah, I guess the question would be, do we want to see how we can maybe set up Beyond Server? Right, I know I'm working on a quick hints video right now about it, actually, but I'm totally happy to do that. Or we could just watch the show.
We'll let you know about some other things taking place next week. You guys will get some notices about some additional live streams we're going to have taking place. We're going to be focusing a little bit, shifting gears and going to setup and safety. So next week, keep an eye out for a newsletter. It's going to mention the laser, some information about how to set up your projectors in a safe and compliant manner. And we'll have a live stream touching on that as well. So keep an eye out for that.
Yeah, mind if I quickly comment on that?
Yes.
So we have, I'll just reiterate it. We have three different setup videos. This is for very much beginners, the setup videos. This is for setting up with in streaming mode with a console, and for auto mode. So anybody who's very new to this, these will be great resources for you. They're kind of designed for as like your first thing to look at. And then once you look at those, you can start looking at quick hints to learn more and more about those topics. And then the big one is a safety video. This is something that has been needed for a long time, and it's been in the process of being created for a long time because obviously we want it to be about as good as we can make it and have as most accurate information as possible. And so that's coming out, and that's going to be a really cool thing that we're really excited to release. And it talks about the on-site safety things that you need to worry about when setting up a laser show. It doesn't talk about the paperwork. That's gonna be a separate video that's mm-hmm. gonna be coming because it's gonna be focused for US customers, because that's what we're focusing on in terms of projectors, sales and whatnot. So, but this safety video is based off of mostly the laws in the United States, but also really good international standards for setting up a laser show safely. So it's, while it is kind of meant for on-site safety for the United States from more of a like a official standpoint, pretty much everywhere, if you follow the rules that are in that video, you're gonna operate a safe show.
Absolutely.
And so we're really excited to be releasing that, and I hope you enjoy it. And we did about as good as we could. obviously, we could go for years trying to make it as perfect as possible, but obviously, we want to get it out so people can operate a safe show. If they, and if you see people doing an unsafe show, because you know some people are just gonna try and do whatever they want, you can direct them towards this video. We finally have something really, really good to direct them towards, which is not going to make you feel bad for not knowing, but it's going to give you all the information that you're going to need.
Absolutely. It was kind of all prefaced. We worked with the FDA to develop these videos. We got some input from them. We got some input from a few industry leading safety consultants, and the overall sentiment was that there needed to be some stronger training for customers when they first get a laser, showing them how to safely and compliantly set it up. So as Lyra had mentioned, these videos will focus primarily on US regulations, but those are a great guideline no matter where you're working in the world. So we'd love you to join us on those that live stream next week. We're planning on doing it on the 15th, if I'm not mistaken. And we'll be opening that up for questions and comments as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so those will be published actually pretty soon. So take a look out. You can go check them out on YouTube if you want, but we'll definitely be pushing them next week for people to start looking at. But if you want to go get a sneak peek, they'll be published with probably today, right? Tomorrow? Tomorrow. They'll be published tomorrow. So they'll be up on YouTube tomorrow, so take a look for those. And give us some early feedback, and yeah, that'd be great.
All right, everyone. Well, it looks like most of the questions are dying down, so we're going to play an encore of the show we opened up with. And again, if you have any comments while that show's playing, throw them in the feed. We'll still be happy to answer them. And after that, we will bid farewell and see you on next week's live stream.
Thank you, guys, and enjoy the show.
sent in me so deep. I wanna tell you something. Dressed in a stunning red, your head upon my chest, the pain inside means nothing. Take off your shirt and lay down, right now.
So yeah, we thank you guys for watching and enjoying the show, and I suppose keep practicing, keep learning new skills and beyond, and or Quick Show if you're using Quick Show user.
Stay positive right now. Stay positive.
Yeah.
Keep a positive mindset. This stuff's gonna pass, and you know, reach out to your clients like we were saying earlier. Check in with them, let them know you're still weathering the storm, and just stay positive. Keep a positive mindset. There's enough doom and gloom in the world, and let's all just kind of be a beacon of light during what are, in some cases, a dark day, and keep that positive mindset going. So.
And I know, everybody is itching to go to a show right now. I can only imagine. I don't even go to shows unless I'm doing it, and I'm like, I can imagine as soon as people are going to be able to, people are going to start. This stuff's going to start rolling again because everyone's going to be itching to do it. So as soon as everything is safe and we're able to do it, I'm almost certain we're going to be, it's going to be crazy again.
With these live streams too, we're obviously they're mostly going to focus on educational content, but we are really trying to send you guys just some information about what's going on industry wide. You know, we've got a lot of partners around the world, so we'll be sharing information as we get it just to keep you updated on what's going on industry wise wide as well. So. Anyway, guys, I want to thank you for joining us. Lyra, Calvin, Josh, and to the whole team here at Pangolin, thank you guys for another awesome live stream. We hope you all enjoyed it, and we'll see you on the next one.